to that glorious day. We thank you so much for the sacrifice and the cross and all that you've done. And we know that you will return one day. I just pray that we're all gathered together with you in heaven one day. And we pray for Brother Andy as he comes. In Jesus' name, amen.
What a great thing to be able to sing those truths of those songs, that our Savior is alive, that He's coming back again, and that's going to be a glorious day, isn't it? That's something we can all look forward to with expectation, knowing that our King lives, and He's coming back for us. And so my prayer is that every single one of us would be ready for that day, that we would know and long for that day and look forward to, because we know how great Jesus is. Because we know how much He has done for us and how much He loves us, and we long to be with Him forever. And so what great truths we've been singing all morning about how powerful our God is, what He was crucified for, what He was risen for, and the life that He now brings. And so good morning to you. I'm glad to see the sun coming through these windows this morning on this Easter. This brings a little more joy to the day, right? And I hope each of you all have a great day celebrating Easter together with family and friends. And as we prepare to go to God's Word and hear what God has to say to us, let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer and just ask for His presence here. Father, we are overflowing this morning with joy out of what You've done. As we think about this past Friday and Good Friday, we celebrated the sacrifice that You paid for us on the cross. You bore our own sins in Your body on the cross for us. We should have been on that cross, Father, and yet You put Jesus on that cross for us. And yet that wasn't the end. Lord, today we celebrate the fact that You conquered death and the grave forever. That we can now have the hope of eternal life with Christ, and that's worth singing about. That's worth celebrating this morning. May we never lose sight of that as we leave Easter Sunday and go to other days. May we never lose sight, may we never get over what You have done. And so as we turn our hearts and our minds to Your Word this morning, we know that, God, Your Word is living and active just as You are living and active. These words come from You. They speak life to us. So, Father, I pray that You would overwhelm us with Your words this morning, that You would overwhelm us with the Spirit of Your presence here with us today, knowing that You are here. Speak to us, draw us close to You. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So as we come together this morning, we celebrate Easter together. We celebrate the fact that Jesus rose from the dead. That's why we're here. We celebrate that He was crucified, that He rose on a cross, that the grave could not hold Him. Nothing could hold Him back from what He came to accomplish. And so I want to start this morning just out of Luke 24, the traditional story of Easter. And we're going to start with that, and then we're going to move to another passage and spend the rest of our time there. But if you want to follow along with me, if you have your Bibles, turn to Luke 24, verses 1 through 6. Or you can follow along on the screens with us. So let me read God's Word for us this morning. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came to the tomb, bringing the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. They went in but did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men stood by them in dazzling clothes. So the women were terrified and bowed down to the ground. "Why are you looking for the living among the dead?" asked the men. "He is not here, but He has been resurrected." That is worth celebrating right there, right? That is what we are rejoicing in today, that Jesus has done this. And so as we think about that, I want us to kind of shift directions, and I want us to ask ourselves a question. If somebody came to you and asked you personally why the resurrection was so important today, 2,000 years later, how would you answer? Yes, a man rose from the dead 2,000 years ago. But why is that important today? What would you say to somebody? That's an important question. I think we should all be ready to answer that question. And so maybe you haven't thought about that before, but what would you say? Why does it matter that Jesus rose from the dead? Well, today we're going to look at an encounter that happened actually 3 years before Jesus rose from the dead, before his resurrection, that helps us answer that question. Because we know that the Bible is not just about one story, but yet the whole Bible points to that one story, right? The whole Bible is meant to bring us before Jesus so we can see and grasp the weight of who Jesus really is and what he came to do. And so as we look at this event 3 years before, we're going to see that Jesus knew why he came. He knew why he came to this earth, why he was going to be resurrected. It was not a surprise to him. And he meant to drop hints along the way to help prepare us for what he was about to do so that we might understand its importance. So we've been going through the book of John together here at Safe Harbor, and we're going to continue along with that this morning. We're going to see how the book of John and how even in John 2, the beginning of the book of John, points us to Jesus and his resurrection. And we're going to see something very important. We're going to see that the resurrection of Jesus should change how we think about worship. It should change how we worship God ourselves. It should change those things in our life. So let's see how that happens. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and flip to John 2. We're going to read 13 through 25. First thing we're going to see is we're going to see just the importance of worship and what it is in Jesus' eyes. All right. So Jesus, last week, we saw he had done this miracle. He had gone to a wedding, and he had turned water into wine at this wedding. And this miracle kind of kicked off Jesus' ministry. It kind of made him public for the first time that, wow, this guy is doing some great things. So we're thinking in ourselves, well, he starts off with this huge miracle. What's going to be next? It's got to be some great thing. And I think what we're going to find out is a little bit surprising. He doesn't do what we might think he would do after this miracle at the wedding. All right, so starting in verse 13. John chapter 2. The Jewish Passover was near, so Jesus went up to Jerusalem. All right, let me stop there for a moment, because this is the setting of what's going on. Right, so Jesus goes from the wedding, he goes to Jerusalem. And as we know in Israel's life and in the Jewish life, Jerusalem is the center of everything. Right, it's where the temple is, and that's where Jesus goes. He goes to the temple. And the temple was of huge importance in their life. It was the place where, it was the central place of worship for God. It's where the Jews had to go to worship God. It's where sacrifices were made for their own sin, to cover their sins so that God would not, so that God would withhold his anger for them. And he wouldn't judge them as they deserved to be judged. And it was the only place where God and people could meet. So the temple was the most important place in that culture, in their life. And Jesus comes to the temple, and he comes during Passover. Now, Passover was one of three annual festivals in Jewish life. And it was one of the biggest celebrations because it was a time when the Jews remembered when God brought them out of Egypt, when he rescued them from slavery. If you know of Moses, the Ten Commandments was on TV last night. I don't know if any of y'all saw it. It's on every Easter. But that's what they celebrate, the Passover. And God rescuing and delivering them. And so the point is, look, there's a lot of people that are coming to Jerusalem, pilgrims from all across the ancient world that are coming to celebrate this ancient event. So the city of Jerusalem is packed full of people, and they're coming to worship God. But something happens when Jesus walks into that temple. So Jesus is about to get pretty intense. It's not the Jesus you may think of, who's this mild-mannered, meek guy who seems kind of like a wimpy guy, right? That's not the Jesus we're going to see here. We're going to see a man's man come out. All right, so look at verse 14 in John chapter 2. In the temple complex, he found people selling oxen, sheep, and doves, and he also found the money changers sitting there. After making a whip out of cords, he drove everyone out of the temple complex with their sheep and their oxen. He also poured out the money changers' coins and overturned the tables. He told those who were selling doves, "Get these things out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a marketplace." And his disciples then remembered that it is written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." That's a quote from Psalm 69 where David is concerned about the worship of God, and he's getting attacked by others who are like, "Man, you're crazy for being that concerned about the temple and God's worship." And it was consuming David. And now they're equating that to Jesus. That it was a prophecy about the coming Messiah, how he would be concerned about the worship of God. And so does Jesus have your attention yet this Easter Sunday morning, his quiet place here? I mean, this guy's, he's made a whip and just running everybody out of there and turning coins and coins scattering all over the place. He's serious about this, right? I think we get the picture. Jesus is serious about what's going on in the temple. And so what's the problem? Why is he doing all this? Well, some people think it's because they were using it for material gain or something like that. But the fact is that the people needed animals to sacrifice, so there was nothing wrong with selling animals for sacrifices. That needed to happen. It was actually a service to the Jews. And there's no hint here that they were extorting them or anything like that and taking their money. But the problem is where they are doing it. They are selling all these animals in the temple complex. In the temple complex, that's where worship happened. And that's where they were supposed to encounter God. But instead, they have all these animals everywhere. So imagine this morning in your seat, a cow sitting right next to you. It'd be kind of hard to worship, wouldn't it? Or a sheep. Right? Sheep are loud sometimes. You're going to be distracted. Well, that's what was going on in the temple that day when Jesus walks into it. He's like, how are people going to worship with all this craziness going on around this area? Most people believe that this happened in the court of the Gentiles. And so this was the outer portion of the temple, and it's the only place where people who weren't born Jewish could worship. So you have all these people that came from all these different places to worship God, and now they can't. Right? They just can't focus on God. And this infuriates Jesus. He says, worshiping God is the most important thing these people should be doing, not selling animals or any of that. That's important, but that's nothing compared to what should be going on between God and people. And so he drives the people out, and in his mind, all this religious activity, that's what it is. They came to do sacrifices, these religious activities, they miss the whole point. Right? They're there, but they're not really there. They're there just to go through their routines, their activities, where they're trying to think they're doing their good deeds. They're worshiping God because they're doing these things. Right? So Jesus is consumed with the worship of God. And that quote from Psalm says that zeal consumed him. When we think about zeal, we think about passion, right? You think about, man, this is something I love. This is something I want more than anything else. It's an intense focus on something. So what are you zealous about in your life? You know, I think we have a variety of people in here today. We're probably zealous for different things, right? It's spring, so some of us might really like getting out in the yard and planting flowers and doing landscaping, and so you're zealous. Man, I'm going to have this great yard. It's going to look awesome. Some of us, I went to a house this week and visited somebody, and this guy was zealous for UK. I thought I was zealous for UK. This guy was zealous. I walk in, he's like, I got to show you my basement, man. He walks me around, and there's autographs on the wall. There's posters from like 1950, 1970 of all these UK teams. And some of you are like, oh, great, he's talking about UK again. This guy was zealous for UK. He was passionate about it. Right? So we have things in our life. God wants us to be passionate about things that we do in our life. But more than anything, he wants us to be passionate about God. He wants us to be passionate to know him and to worship him. And the truth is, we have a tendency in our lives to be like these Jews in the temple. Worship can become just another activity where we do certain things and we make certain efforts to try to please God ourselves. And it becomes about what we do more than it becomes about the God that we worship. And we think we can make ourselves good enough before him. But Jesus came to help us understand it's not about us. It's not how far we travel to get to church or get to the temple. Not about the animals that we're paying money for to sacrifice, which we don't do anymore. But it's not about anything that we can do. It's about what God has done for us. It's about our great God bringing us into his presence. And that's what Jesus is so concerned about here. For Jesus, worship was important because he knew the greatness of God. That's why worship was important. Nothing else. Because that God is infinitely worthy of our worship and our time and everything else in our life. So as we think about what it means to be a Christian, and in this room, if you say, well, I consider myself a Christian, what does that mean? Well, the Bible tells us being a Christian means being made like Christ. The word Christian actually means little Christ. That's what it means. So that means we think like Christ. We act like Christ. We feel like Christ. That's what, when we bear the name Christian, that's what we say we're doing. So if Jesus has this mindset towards worship, that means if we say we're a Christian, we should have that mindset for worship. And we should take it seriously. And it should be all about God and not about us. And everything else becomes less significant compared to it because we're zealous about worship. Everything, we're committed to it because we want it more than anything. We're zealous for it. We're excited about worship. We're excited about thinking about God and who He is and what He's done. So this morning, as you've come to this place, is that why you came to this worship service? Because you're zealous for God. Because you know how great He is. You know what He's done in the resurrection and in the crucifixion. And you wanted to worship Him. Worship matters. And Jesus shows us that here. But He also makes it possible. We're going to see the second thing here is we see how the resurrection changes our worship. We're here to celebrate the resurrection. And Jesus actually talks about His resurrection 3 years before He actually was resurrected. And He did it so it would change our worship. So the Jews are going, they see Jesus going crazy here in the temple, and they respond, right? They're not just going to sit there and say, oh, we'll just let this guy do all this crazy stuff and drive everybody out. No, they respond, and they approach Him. Look at verse 18 in John 2. So the Jews replied to Him, what sign of authority will you show us for doing these things? Jesus answered, destroy this sanctuary, destroy this temple, and I will raise it up in 3 days. Therefore the Jews said, this temple, this sanctuary, took 46 years to build, and you will raise it up in 3 days? But He was speaking about the sanctuary, the temple of His body. So when He was raised from the dead, His disciples remembered that He had said this. So 3 years later, the disciples remember Jesus saying this before. And they believed the scripture and the statement Jesus had made. The disciples remembered and they believed because they had seen it firsthand. All right, so here we see the Jewish authorities coming to Jesus and they want Him to prove He has the authority to do the things He's doing. Because basically what He's doing is He's going against what the Jewish leaders were allowing. Right? They had allowed these people to come in here and do this activity to sell these animals. They didn't run them off. And now Jesus is saying, no, these leaders, they got it wrong. Don't listen to them. Listen to Me. Get out of here. And they're saying, well, who are you to do this? We don't know you. We don't know you from Adam. How are you going to do that? And Jesus' answer just leaves them with like this blank stare on their face. He said, destroy this temple and I'm going to build it up in 3 days. And they're like, what are you talking about? It took 46, this is a huge building. It takes years, it took 46 years to build this temple and you're going to build it up in 3 days. Because they thought He was talking about the physical temple. Right, the physical place of worship, the physical place where sacrifices happen for sin. But He was actually talking about His own body. He was talking about the resurrection, the thing we celebrate today. He was telling them, look, I'm going to be killed. My body is going to be physically destroyed. And I'm going to raise it up. I'm going to come out of the grave. I'm going to conquer death. And that's what we celebrate. And the disciples remember that and they believe it later on as they see it happen. But why would Jesus say that at the moment that these people are questioning His authority? Why would Jesus answer that way? It seems kind of like a strange answer, doesn't it? But the truth is, Jesus is telling them, look, I have authority to do these things, to drive you all out, because I am now the true place of worship. The temple is no longer meant to be the center of worship. It comes through Me, through Jesus. Because I am God. I am the Son of God come for you. So all worship of the God who rules and reigns over all things comes through Me now. I'm going to rise from the dead to prove it. That's what He's saying. If rising from the dead doesn't prove His authority, what will? The worship now comes through Him. The temple is replaced by Jesus. John 14, 6. No one comes to the Father but through Me. That means no one comes to worship God but through Jesus. You have to know Him. He's the new temple. You don't worship God in the temple anymore. Matthew 12, 6. Something greater, Jesus says, something greater than the temple is here. He's talking about Himself. He's greater than the temple. Because the temple, you had to sacrifice over and over again for sin, right? Jesus did it once and for all. When we trusted him, he sacrificed for our sins forever. In the temple, that's the only place you can meet God. You were constrained to that one physical place. Now you can meet God wherever because Jesus comes to live in us when we follow him. We can know God day in and day out wherever we are. We can commune with God. That's what prayer is, right? God speaks to us when we know him. And so we know that through Jesus and his resurrection, worship becomes about a person, not a place. And the resurrection showed the disciples this. Don't think you can only worship in this room today. Don't think that. You can worship when you leave this place, wherever you go. That's what Jesus' resurrection proves. And so you see how this changes our worship. It's not about what we do. It's about what Christ has done for us. We don't go to a building. He's come to us. We don't go. He comes. He died for our sins, and he lives in us so we can know him. So when we become Christians, Christ lives in us. And we live with him. That's why Paul calls our bodies temples. He calls our bodies temples because Christ is in us. 1 Corinthians 6. And that worship then happens when we know him. Right? When we understand the weight of who Jesus is and the fact that he's come to us, the worship just happens. It comes out of our souls, out of a love for this great Savior. Because we value him. We see his value and his worth, his infinite goodness. And that leads to worship, not a place. And we're called to do that continually. It becomes a lifestyle where we're changed from the inside out, where we want to worship God. And the resurrection changes that and makes it possible. So we see how important worship is. We see how Jesus changes our worship forever with his death and with his resurrection. But we also need to know what to do with that. Okay, that's great. Jesus made all this possible. What does he want from us? And what we're going to see is what Jesus wants from us is genuine worship. Not going through the motions. He wants genuine worship. Look at verses 23 through 25 in John 2. While he was in Jerusalem at the Passover festival, many trusted in his name when they saw the signs he was doing. Jesus, however, would not entrust himself to them, since he knew them all, and because he did not need anyone to testify about man, for he himself knew what was in man. He knew what was in them. So what's that saying, right? So Jesus, while he's there in Jerusalem, he's continuing to do signs and miracles, all right? And the people are seeing this, just like the water to wine, all right? Man, this guy is doing some crazy stuff. I'm going to believe him because he's doing it right in front of my eye. That's what's happening. There's some level of belief in Jesus simply because of what he's doing. But what we see here is that belief was only superficial. It was just surface level. It didn't really mean anything to them. And how do we know that? Well, in verse 25, it tells us, well, Jesus said himself knew what was in man. What he's saying is that Jesus knew their hearts. Yeah, they say with their mouths, they believe in their heads that, yeah, he's doing these things, I'm going to believe in him, but their hearts didn't really, they weren't changed. They weren't loving Christ for who he really was, the weight of who he was. And so we see that this is actually a wordplay in the Greek language. Right? It's basically saying, look, the people believed in Jesus, but he did not believe in them. They had faith in him, but he did not have faith in their faith. That's what it's saying. Jesus knew their hearts didn't really love him. They were just there going through the motion. They were just saying they followed him. And we know that because at the end of Jesus' life, he had very few people that actually stuck with him. Right? And so it's proof. These people didn't really care. They didn't follow him the whole time he was on earth. Think about it. If we really knew who Jesus was, and he was doing miracles 3 years before he died, I don't know about you, but I'm sticking with that guy. Right? If my faith is real, I'm not leaving his side until he leaves me. And these people, it just passes by because their hearts weren't genuine. And Jesus knew their hearts. Do you know today that Jesus knows your heart? He knows all things because he's God. He knows why every single one of us are here today in this room. And what he wants is he wants hearts that love him, that treasure him above all else, that see what he's done, how he's come for us. He's died for our sins. He's taken our place, sacrificed himself. He rose from the dead to conquer that. And he wants our hearts to be loving him because of the weight of those things. So he knows if you're faking it today. And it's possible, as we see right here, to think that we have real faith when we have no faith at all. It's possible to deceive ourselves into thinking that. So is our faith real? Is it changing our hearts? Is it changing our lives to want to follow Christ, to want to know him, to want to be like him? Or is it fake? We just pretend like we're good with God. Jesus tells us that's not saving faith. This is serious business. This is serious. And the resurrection shows, man, this is a God who is worthy of our complete faith, our complete devotion. So let me ask you today, do you have faith that leads to real worship? Genuine worship from our hearts. Does God need to change your heart today? Do you realize, man, I might have been faking it for the last 10 years of my life. I might have just been going through the motions and I didn't really know God. Do you see evidence in your life of God's work and presence? Because he's alive. Because he lives. He's not in the grave. Jesus died. He knew he would die. And he did it for you. And if you see him, if you see the cross as the greatest sacrifice anybody could ever make for you, for all your sins, and you believe in that, you acknowledge your need for that, your own sinfulness before God, and your punishment that you deserve from him, and that Jesus took that punishment for you, if you believe that, and you see that, and you love Jesus because of that, and you give your life to him because he lives, that's what it means to be a Christian. Do you need that today? Do you need God to declare you innocent before him, and you're not sure where you stand? He rose from the dead so we could have eternal life with him. Not just eternal life with him. Is your life with him today? He's a glorious, resurrected Savior who loves us and wants us to know him, to experience him in our life. And that's my prayer for you, and that's my prayer for every one of us. We would know this God. Let's pray together. God, we just thank you for this word. Lord, that the resurrection, the crucifixion and the resurrection were not a surprise, God. You knew what you were doing. And you want us to know what you did. And you point us to that throughout the whole Bible. It all goes down to Jesus. And his sacrifice and his love for us so that we can know you, God. I pray if any of us in this room don't know you, that we would come to know you today. That our lives would be defined by a real worship, a worship of you that's been changed by the resurrected Christ. A worship that is no longer a surface level, superficial, just activity that we go through, we have to do once a week. And that worship becomes our life. And we love it. And we enjoy it. And we live in your presence forever. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we're going to sing a song just of invitation and reflection. And this is a time where we need to respond to how God is calling us to respond. And so how do you need to respond to God's word today? What has he shown you about your heart? If you would, we'll stand and sing and just respond. I'll be down here at the front. Would love to talk to anybody who needs to respond this morning. Let's sing together.